Bom, vamos dar início então à segunda parte desse nosso seminário. O professor Gary Dymski vai fazer a apresentação dele. O professor já é velho conhecido aqui da casa, tem colaborado com a gente ao longo do tempo. E agora cada vez mais, né, com esse acordo de cooperação que fizemos com a Universidade de Leeds. Então é um prazer recebê-lo aqui novamente, professor. It's a pleasure to receive you here again. I'd like to thank you for your presentation, for your visit. You are very happy with this cooperation, especially now with this term of cooperation with Leeds University. Thank you, and the stage is yours. Thank you.
All right. Thanks very much. Let's see about this mic. Is this okay? All right. Yeah, let me say that if you have not heard, we are building some pathways for cooperation between Unicampi, especially the Instituto de Economia, and Leeds University. So if you are a student and you're interested, please get in touch. We hope to exchange research, students, faculty at all levels. So actually, my talk today, in a sense, is something very familiar. It's from a paper that was published some time ago. Like Roberto, I'm going to be participating in the SPIDER program, and I have a series of lectures, one of which is on this theme. And as I was talking to Ana Rosa about what to present today, she thought this might be appropriate. And actually, I took the chance to put this back together and then to finish by thinking a little bit about Brazil. In some sense, what we have to set the scene for this paper, what we have here is a situation of an economy which is, in a sense, beginning at the point where some of the economies that Roberto is talking about are finishing. That is to say, an economy where stagnation is a problem, where industrial growth is really going backwards, where we've been hit by the global factory. Here there's a discourse, as we know, about Dutch disease. But in the United States, we are so far advanced into the era of global factory that we don't even have that discourse. What we have are whole areas of the economy, whole areas of people that basically are not needed anymore. And when we have these people who are not needed for productive enterprise, in the context of a stagnant economy that is basically under attack, with Keynesian policies under attack, we have this problem of basically people who have human needs and who are, in some sense, potential customers of enterprises, but who have too little income. And that, in a way, is the beginning of the story of the subprime crisis. And I'm going to draw some parallels toward the end of this talk with Brazil. I don't want to hit it too hard, because there are so many structural differences between the two countries and between the trends that we see in the countries, but there are a couple worth mentioning. The other thing I want to draw out, especially for those of you who are students, is that what I think you will see today is, I hope you'll see, is a talk that basically is rooted in one of the central figures of post-war Keynesian theory, the work of Hyman Minsky. And when people sort of ask people, are you Keynesian? My answer is certainly yes. And sometimes when we think of ourselves in those ways, I'm a Keynesian or an institutionalist or a Marxian, We think of it as we can think of it as a kind of shackle, like we put ourselves in with the responsibility of just replicating the work. And actually, my thought would be just the opposite, that if you're interested in the ideas of a Keynes or a Minsky or a Frankel or any other figure, a Dekesh, take their ideas, work with those ideas, and what can you do that hasn't been done? How can you go to a new place, go to something creative that in some sense builds on tradition but's different? So we're going to try to see Dymski differently today, and we're going to do that by seeing the ways in which he did and did not give us something to think about with the subprime crisis. Now, there's the old man. He wore that sweater every day. David, you know, we never saw him without that sweater. I hope that he has it on still. And for those of you who knew him, you know, we miss him. He was like a grandpa, avo, and a very cariñoso man, a very, very special man. Now, I want to start by emphasizing that in some sense, at the root of Dymski's work, as I read it, there's this intellectual struggle. And it's basically this recognition that there is a fundamental instability in capitalism, which he at the same time thought could be controlled. And the thing is, though, that he recognized that the former was for sure, and he had hopes about the latter. And to kind of illustrate this, I want to take for you this box of writings collected at the Levy Institute, where all of his writings are now there. And just take a look. I'm going to do some circling. Let's look at the themes that we see. First of all, you know, we see a chapter from this rough draft book about the emergence of financial instability, a key dynamic of capitalism. By the same token, he wants, right, in the same volume, he wants to talk about how the sky did not fall. Now, if you go through Dymski's drafts, you will see that this title of The Sky Did Not Fall recurs again and again, 1982, 1986, etc. He's always going back to this idea that the sky did not fall, and yet we always got to the point where the sky was almost falling. So this hope that you could contain this dynamic instability was there, and basically his doubts about how it could be contained. On the one hand, notice in one chapter, he's talking about the lender of last resort effect. In another chapter, he's talking about the impact of big government. And you know, these are all unfinished drafts as he was playing with his ideas. I think those of you who have seen his book, Stabilizing the Unstable Economy, will know that it's a very peculiar book. 1986. It's the last work that he really put together all as one piece. And I think that it sort of does not very well represent his core ideas, just because I think there was such a struggle going on in his mind about how to think about these things. So let's fast forward for a minute to Dymski's 15 minutes of fame. And you know, everybody gets their 15 minutes of fame, and Dymski got his. The Dymski moment became the thing. And there's a famous article by Martin Wolf, September 16th, 2008, by Monday of this week. Three of Wall Street's top banks had disappeared. What was until recently the brave new US financial system is melting away before our eyes. Oh, if it had. Over the past 3 weeks, says Martin Wolf, he's been reading. In particular, he reread Dymski's masterpiece, Stabilizing an Unstable Economy. What went wrong? The short answer, Dymski was right. Basically, undue faith in regulated markets proved a snare. So there's kind of, vengeance or satisfaction. But, you know, basically, if Dymski was right, how come the United States economy is so stagnant? Basically, you know, if the sky did not fall in 1982 or 1987 or 1975, it sure did fall in 2007, 2008. And why has it remained on the ground? So we're going to take a journey today through some of Dymski's work. And we're going to start by basically in the first at the beginning. You know, Dymski talks about loan commitments become unsustainable because they generate negative cash flows. We have Ponzi finance. This is, in some sense, implicit in some of the way that Roberto is looking at the cross-border relationships at different points in time. And the thing is that, you know, cash flows are one thing, but insolvency is another, and this is something that's really not mentioned in Dymski's work. I think there's reasons for that, but he misses, in some sense, if this is the Wall Street view, the balance sheet approach to capitalism, we don't see a lot of balance sheet in Dymski's analysis of what's happening. He focuses on debt, second point, by business. And loans in his model are productive loans. They're linked to profit-making activities. And until you get too strung out and then everything crashes. But basically, that said, it's a focus on business. And, you know, the thing is, we don't see in Dymski the idea of non-productive loans. We don't see the idea of loans that are not made for profit-generating activities, but that can be speculative or predatory. So there's another missing piece. And also in his vision, you know, what we see is banks as the pressure point. Banks are the engine room. This is the Schumpeter of capitalism in him. And actually, that's not always the case. I think, you know, if you think about it, if you look at Dymski's work, and if we put him into the frame of the circuitist approach, or we put him in the frame of the social structure of accumulation approach, what we see there is that, you know, he's really reflecting on a period that was the golden age of capitalism. And he finds the movement toward financial instability inside the golden age. And that's something that basically is kind of heretical. Everything is not going well. We can have instability. But at the same time, the further developments really escape him. Even as he's writing, and if you look at those drafts, you'll see that he was writing Stabilizing an Unstable Economy for many years. He was writing it even while we were still understanding the consequences of leaving the Bretton Woods system. And so in some sense, Dymski gives us a theory, a formulated theory that he struggled to express very well. But that said, it really comes from one particular part of capitalism, an epoch of capitalism that was in some ways much more tame than what we've seen now. In particular, an epoch when finance was still largely controlled as opposed to what happened later. So these invisible assumptions are really, you know, underlying his vision of how we can stabilize the unstable economy. But, you know, there's other worlds, and we're in another world right now. We're in a world where, first of all, asset liability balances are as crucial as cash flows. And basically, I want to tell a story today about how the crisis that we have seen in the U.S., still unresolved, has been so profound for several reasons, but the ones I want to focus on are, first of all, banks were no longer at the center of the origination of and the bearing as well as the origination of credit risk. Secondly, banks were making exploitative loans, not just productive loans, and they were generalizing these loans as housing prices took off. And thirdly, these loans were often made to the household sector, not to the corporate sector, and basically there were units in the economy, including some of the borrower units, that became more leveraged than banks. And this became a huge point where the economy slid out of the control of the Federal Reserve and I would argue still is out of the control of the Federal Reserve. So these modifications basically allow us to really see the crisis and understand why it's been so hard. What we're going to do is we're going to bring in the role of racial exclusion and social inequality in financial dynamics. We're going to talk about the U.S. in the frame of the global economy and why we see securitization emerge as it did in the U.S. And then thirdly, we're going to talk about the transformation, the systematic transformation of banks. Okay, let's go to some basics. Things we all know, that, you know, we start, well, one place to start with Keynes is with uncertainty. And basically investment that's driven by beliefs that are unstable and unfounded in anything fundamental and that depend on confidence. Dymski really starts here and basically builds up a story about how economic units take on positions that expose them to fragility. The idea, of course, is that we see units gaining confidence, believing that their expectations are rooted in reality, that reality is their friend. They get more and more aggressive as they get involved in the competitive process until the cash flow requirements overwhelm expectations. There's a bump and the thing goes down. So this is his phrase, stability is destabilizing. The very fact that the units competing in the capitalist economy are basically so confident that they must compete to survive and to excel ultimately becomes their downfall. This is a kind of vision of, it's like a kind of a gothic vision of Schumpeter, right, in a way. Now, the thing is that it's not about a Dymski moment then, it's about a process. And the thing is that Dymski himself is not very clear about what he means. He struggles to express his ideas. If you've read through the 1975 book, the 1982 essays, the essays scattered through other books, the 1986, you'll see many different representations. He's constantly cutting and chopping and expressing things differently, using these in different ways. Now, part of this was actually revealed in a comment that Ben Friedman made at the Festschrift conference for Dymski in St. Louis in 1991. It's where I met Dymski, actually, the first time. There was this kind of discussion about what was the right way to express the ideas about financial instability. And essentially, Ben Friedman was defending the idea that we should use asymmetric information. Said, look, you know, it's just another way to say a set of ideas. And said Ben Friedman, now, of course, the very pragmatic Harvard economist, it doesn't matter if it's the most important thing, the way of seeing things, but it's we have to find the language that mainstream theorists are using and use that language. This was expressed by Michael Kumhoff at Berlin last year by talking about the kind of models you need to use for the people that matter. And that's kind of where Ben Friedman was at. But that's probably one reason why Dymski was unclear, much like Keynes in the general theory. Keynes is trying to talk to several different audiences at once, and those audiences are using different languages. Dymski is trying to hit a moving target and trying to sell his ideas into different audiences. He was not so comfortable with the fact that the people that really got him were people who are part of this community that we call, you know, heterodox economics. He wanted a broader stage than that. Okay, now just to show you, the thing that Dymski would come back to was this idea of the two-price model, which he saw as a very nice way for summarizing the theory. This and what he liked about it was the idea that we imagine that there's a price that is formed by the dynamics of the financial market, and that would be this PK. And then there would be a price that would be the real supply price of an investment good, PI. And the thing is that the one is rooted in real processes and the other in financial markets that can float around and get confused. And basically, the idea here is that if PKPI becomes more than one, you should build a factory because you can instantly, essentially, fund that factory by selling shares. If it's less than one, it's cheaper to buy factories than to make them. This is essentially just theory Q of James Tobin, which was put forth sort of definitively in 1971 in the JMCB. The thing is that, you know, Tobin's theory Q is, of course, rooted in Tobin's portfolio equilibrium vision of capitalism, trying to marry together efficient capital markets with Keynesian macro. It's a very unsuccessful marriage. It lasts only a few years before Robert Lucas and his boys blow it out of the water. But you know, basically, the idea of investment as arbitrage is what we have here, and this really doesn't work. It really doesn't do justice to what Minsky's trying to talk about. It's just an example of something that's so fundamental for Hayek, but that really fundamentally doesn't get us very far. So in some sense, you know, what we might do is just think of the way that Minsky thought of it in terms of balance sheets. And let's, taking the middle of the page, this micro dimension, just imagine that there's an interest rate R that we have to repay. So that's what we've borrowed debt D, and we've got to repay it at rate R. And then we've got a firm that has productive assets K, which it's borrowed against. Now, this is already problematic. This is not exactly what banks do. We know that. But basically, imagine there can be a high return or a low return. The high return, capital P, the low return, small p. It's very easy just to show kind of the journey that Minsky sees as the journey from robust finance through to Ponzi finance. You know, the idea that you pass through stages. Because this is often misunderstood as a situation in which basically somehow in Ponzi everybody goes crazy and loses their minds and is no longer rational. Instead, as I mentioned, we really have a process that's like a Gothic version of Schumpeterian competition. People are competing hard, but conditions change. What specifically happens is that we start with basically the debt repayment requirement being such that under any scenario of cash flows, whether it's the high return, capital P, or the lower return, small p, times the capital, we can always repay. So we have a robust financial structure. We then move as we expand into a fragile structure. That's one where basically there are states of the world where we will not have money to repay. Basically, that is then the middle state. And then finally, we hit the final state where basically, even under the best conditions, we cannot repay. Now, this could be related to the deterioration of markets. Holberto has just given us a masterclass on how changes in prices, changes in exchange rates, and so on can drastically affect all of these factors here. And we were talking about Mexico. You know, Mexico is very dependent on its P and its K as its firms try to, you know, find ways to make profits, working with, of course, in most cases, foreign-owned banks there. So, you know, what we have here is a situation where we start with units that have robust financial structures. And, you know, what I'm after here with this picture is just to show you that, you know, essentially what you're seeing is this kind of elongamento, right? They're stretching here as we move from robust to fragile. They're getting more, they're taking on more liabilities, long-term and short-term, as they're expanding their inventories, expanding their equipment, building more stuff. Essentially, the firm is getting more leveraged. As it gets more leveraged, that's when you get into that situation where your cash flow can start to overwhelm your return, in, you know, leaving aside other factors such as changes in exchange rates. Oops, let's blow that out and continue. Here's just a picture. I use this picture for years. I just like it. So it's basically the idea that, you know, you move to a collapse and have a slaughter of capital. Okay. Now, banks in this theory. Basically, Dymski used to like to say that everybody's a bank, in the sense that all units transform maturity. But actually, what is special about banks is that it's banks who emit liquid deposits and create credit. So essentially, banks are lenders that are in this point of tension between providing liquidity and creating credit. So, you know, there are these then two pressure points in the Dymski cycle. One is that basically, as liquidity risk rises, and that's the risk that this goes back to the first time I met Fernando, we were talking about these models, the liquidity risk in the 80s, and looking at the way in which basically when banks are uncertain if they can fund their asset positions, they're gonna slow down. And if all of their assets are held on their balance sheets, they'll be sensitive to that and maybe slow themselves down. The second pressure point is that essentially the central bank can intervene to save the banks and to provide liquidity when things get to a crisis point. This plus counter-cyclical government spending that will refresh the ability of the units in the non-financial sector to spend is something that will basically get us out of crisis. And this is essentially the central bank, that's the big bank, the counter-cyclical spending, that's the big government, that indeed are counted on to stabilize the unstable economy. That's how the thing works. And so, you know, what we have here is sort of banks at a robust phase where they're basically, the idea here is that, you know, they've got lots of deposits to fund a modest amount of loans. As their balance sheets grow in parallel with those firms we were imagining, they're basically taking on, more borrowing. Their loans are surpassing their deposit base, and essentially they become more sensitive to liquidity risk because this, you know, money market borrowing that they're doing here is something that can essentially become very costly if we have a squeeze in the money market. So essentially, we have this vision of crisis and recovery that depends on several stylized facts. One is that the banks are the most highly leveraged units, and they're vulnerable to default risk and liquidity risk. They're kind of the pressure points. Secondly, the government intervention can stabilize the economy by going in and rescuing banks, which are, after all, the most leveraged. And so essentially, you know, we have this situation, though, that if this is a balance sheet view, how come we're not looking at balance sheets? And the answer, I think, is that actually, with Dymski thinking about the world this way, implicitly, we have a world in which basically the banks are the most leveraged units, followed by households, followed by non-bank firms. So in a sense, it's the most leveraged a balance sheet that becomes hit by the crisis first and is the point of intervention. So, you know, here is, for example, a picture of, you know, three kinds of balance sheets. Here's banks, households, non-financial firms. And just to kind of show that, you know, banks' equity on average, as you know, is something like 10 to 1. Can be even more than that. Now it's in dispute with Basel III. But by contrast, for the U.S. case at least, the typical household has leveraging of about 6 to 1, 16% capital or equity relative to their other positions. Here I just invented kind of a typical U.S. household, especially with cash, credit card commitments, household mortgage, et cetera. And by contrast, non-financial firms are the least leveraged units in the economy, on average about 3 to 1. So in a sense, there's this kind of logic of leverage that is at work here. And basically, we see that the central bank can solve things because, number one, banks are the most leveraged units. Secondly, they do most of the lending. They're the locus of liquidity risk. They have important borrower-lender relationships, and by expanding lending, they can get investment going again. So when there's a speculative bubble, their banks are not going to be in it, and basically the bigger the bank, the more important they are in this process. So the thing is that Financial dynamics move in two dimensions, not one dimension. If we have a movement on the side there of cash flows, you know, what we have is moving from a robust to a fragile to a Ponzi financial position. What if we think about balance sheet positions, it's not that units are staying in the same place with the same wealth. Units' wealth is deteriorating as things get worse. In fact, you know, their wealth is moving to the right, and they are losing net wealth. Their net worth is diminishing. And in bad times, their net wealth becomes, you know, starts to go negative. So this is something that is just an, you know, another dynamic. And when we think about kind of the cash flow aspects of the Dymski cycle, what we have is, in a sense, here's banks, there's households, and there's basically non-bank enterprises. And in a sense, the story that Dymski tells is that, you know, they're sliding as we move down from robust to fragile to Ponzi finance. They're sliding toward dangerous points. And as they do, though, there's intervention on the part of the central bank that pulls the banks out, restores their liquidity, allows them to start lending again, that pulls the economy and especially the non-financial businesses out of the way and basically rescues the economy. The households are basically passive bystanders in this vision of capitalism. They're not that involved. Now the thing is, again, this is a vision that's drawn from the pages of the golden age of capitalism, as Singh and others have called it. This was basically, he's just reporting kind of on what was institutionally true in the world that he was observing. However, that world was undergoing vast changes. I'm going to talk about several. There's many things to report, but here just to focus on three things. The first one is the retooling of the mortgage markets. The housing finance markets in the United States are extremely important markets. They completely fell apart in the early 1980s. The local housing savings associations, the savings and loan associations, fell apart with the spike in interest rates during the Volcker period. And basically, many of those institutions failed, became insolvent, and then failed. There's a story to be told there. I won't bother you with it today. But basically, the way that the system was saved was that what was created was a system of securitized finance. Now, initially, you know, these thrifts that were making loans were very conservative, and they were playing along with conservative lending rules. They were making housing mortgages, home mortgages, that were called plain vanilla. Plain vanilla in the sense that vanilla is a really boring flavor of ice cream. And essentially, you know, what we had was there was a 20% down payment, there was a cap on what percentage of income could be used to repay the loan, and essentially these were plain vanilla in the sense that they were safe. Those very safe loans were then, in a sense, moved over into a securitization process that was underwritten by Fannie and Freddie, by the two government service agencies. And in basically, as such, the mortgage loans became the basis of the mortgage-backed security industry, which by the end of the 1980s was the largest securities market in the world. Meanwhile, banks were transformed. Instead of basically being highly regulated institutions that were, you know, required to make the same kind of loans to the same customers to offer the same deposits, they were free to compete. And they did, and basically they began to segment their customer bases and to do different things with them and to look for more customers as well. So essentially, you know, just to say that the security-based system of finance depended on a number of things. First of all, was standardization of instruments. And that meant initially standardization of eligibility criteria for mortgages. Secondly, there was a separation of loan making from risk taking, risk bearing. Initially, this was available because there were these quasi-public and private entities that were willing to underwrite the risk. The other thing about this solution is that keep in mind that it's in the 1980s that the United States enters a period of systematic current account deficits. It's a period that it really has never left in the 30 plus years since then. That current account deficits imply basically many years of capital account surpluses. Now this is something like China as the banker of the US, that's for sure. But essentially that means that there's a consistent flow of financial assets into the United States seeking assets, and they need something to buy. And especially a lot of the foreign investors in the United States are looking for a kind of liquid safe paper, and this paper looked like a good bet. So essentially, this solution, moving to securitization, conformed with the peculiar place that the United States, and especially Wall Street, had in the global economic system. This is also the period in which Wall Street, in this period of post-regulation, is experimenting with new ways of financing mergers, new forms such as private equity and so on, which are all really driven by this capital account surplus. The geniuses of Wall Street, in some sense, are the prisoners of the structure of US accumulation in the global system as it was at that point in time. This system does really radically transform risk bearing and where the risk is, because essentially what happens, this is with plain vanilla mortgages, is that the risk that was once locused here with the originator, and these mortgage loans would stay here until they were done. They would be held for 30 years, 25 years. These loans were now, you know, taken off the place where they are originated and bundled and sold to investors. And basically the investors were coming from a lot of different places. There's stories to be told there. I'll keep those stories short just for purpose of time. But this was kind of the setup. The risk, the loan origination on the left, the risk bearing on the right. Now, second stage of the institutional evolution is basically the fact that, as I mentioned, banks are looking to find more ways to make money from different customer classes. One of the customer classes that is appealing is actually the customer class of people living in racial minority areas and in lower income areas. These are areas that are subject to this problem of stagnant income. Now, Roberto talked about how we see remittances as being much more important as we go through time, especially for Central America and Mexico, actually for Brazil and many other places too. But one of the things is that the United States, as we move into the 80s, into the 90s, we have more and more guest workers who are working and sending money home. Banks, up until the year 2000, controlled only about 3% of that remittance market. It was not their market. And most of those non-bank people are unbanked. So banks are essentially giving away that whole market. So there's entire areas of inner city communities in the US where banks are, they have withdrawn and they're getting nothing. Now, there had been a community movement that force banks to get involved. Long story, but the short version is that essentially banks began to create financial products that were geared toward making high short-term returns in the form of high interest rates and high fees, high penalties from customers that were financially vulnerable. And so this, there was many loans of this kind of predatory lending is the general term, and that some of these were payday loans, consumer durable credit, debit cards, and especially and most famously, subprime loans. Now, subprime loans were initially made to people living in minority neighborhoods that, as was very famous in work by William Junius Wilson and other people, in areas where there's basically very few jobs for young people. Now, the older residents who owned their homes, these were people who had moved into these minority communities in World War I, World War II and the years just after, when there was a strong demand for labor in the context of the boom economies of those periods. As the wars ended, though, the old patterns returned, and that black labor and brown labor was often surplus labor, and often somebody who had managed to buy a home in the 1940s or 1950s, usually with a black-owned bank, that person might be now the father or mother of sons and daughters and grandsons and granddaughters who might be in the prison industrial complex, who might be without a job, who might have a child out of wedlock, who might have personal circumstances that are difficult and who might need cash. This was the initial target of the subprime loans. These were sold as second mortgages to homeowners in minority neighborhoods. And essentially, the way the terms and conditions were written is that you would get a loan, and the term would be that if you missed a payment, they would take your house. And the reason you got the loan was that you had collateral in your house. So you have your little ghetto house, and you own your little ghetto house, but you take a loan on it because you're getting something from it that you need, cash flow for your family, maybe. But meanwhile, that exposes you to fragility you didn't have before. By 98, as mentioned, a third of all mortgages to African Americans are subprime loans, one-fifth to Latinos. This lending grows 900% in the 1990s. Now, what's happening at this time is that, you know, banks don't want to hold this paper. Banks, by then, banks and other lenders are exploring the possibilities for securitized markets, and indeed, at the same time, we have new suppliers of credit, demanders of credit, let me say it, that are coming in. We have, first of all, hedge funds, private equity funds, looking to beat the market rate of interest. We have bank holding companies coming in and buying subprime lenders. The names wouldn't mean anything to you, but something like these short-term lenders you see on the street started to market mortgages. And the big banks get involved, often through holding company relationships, not directly. So this market, all the pieces are being put into place. And that then brings us to the final part of the story. The final part of the story is that the subprime machinery is there, and this is already a disease in the markets. I should note that in 1994, the US Congress passes an act, a bill, that requires that there be limits on subprime lending and predatory lending. Alan Greenspan, who was then in charge of the Federal Reserve, you know, the way the US system works, you're seeing an example now, or at least the way it used to work, is that Congress passes a bill, they give it to the president signs the bill, it then goes to the appropriate agency, that agency then is mandated to implement the bill. Punto. Done. Actually, you're seeing now, or maybe if you'll notice, there's a debate in the United States about Obamacare, health care that was passed several years ago, not yet implemented, basically because they're dragging their feet. The same thing is true with Dodd-Frank, the financial reforms, not yet implemented years after as they're dragging their feet. Where this, the master at this, though, was Alan Greenspan. Alan Greenspan took the Anti-Subprime Lending Act, put it in his pocket, said he didn't understand it. The Federal Reserve was responsible for implementing this act. They did not even submit regulations under this act until 2005, the height of the subprime lending. So there is your hero of Ayn Rand capitalism. Basically standing up to and not doing a bill. And there's Bill Clinton, right, who's part of the Graham-Bliley Act, signing the complete deregulation and going along with that, advised by Robert Rubin. A lot of forces coming to play, but a lot of those big forces, a lot of the Wall Street players, Goldman Sachs and JP Morgan and all the players you see now in the lawsuits, were involved directly or indirectly. in creating, distributing, selling, underwriting, speculating on, and writing derivatives against this paper. So, you know, it was a big game. And the game got even bigger in the 2000s when basically, you know, what we saw was the capacity of this market growing so that, you know, we could now have, with subprime loans and with other kinds of predatory loans and other paper, the markets, and with the growth of the computation capacity by computers, there was now the capacity to bundle heterogeneous loans into assets. They figured out the math, and they could basically have then securities that could be bundled into into securitized instruments backed by, there were now private backers, AIG, for example, so that the process didn't depend on the willingness of the federal agencies, Fannie and Freddie, to underwrite plain vanilla loans. Now they could underwrite speculative loans on their own private markets. In fact, Fannie and Freddie are now in trouble, in part because they got into the game later. They were bypassed by the market. Again, there's a longer story there, but that's the part of it. So all the machinery is there just when the housing bubble hits. And the housing bubble hits, and at that point, we see the subprime loans go beyond the inner city, beyond the minority communities, into the broader markets. This is a picture of basically the old and the new system. And just to show you, you know, all the players involved in the system on the right, you know, the bank is no longer even the lender. The bank, in some sense, is the intermediary that makes the connection. The bank's like a dealer, is the way that Perry Merling calls it. The bank makes a connection between the borrower, the broker, and ultimately the lender, which is the fund that buys the bundled security, and here's the underwriters and the others involved. Impossible market to regulate unless you basically, you know, have the willingness. That's part of the reason we see Dodd-Frank not yet implemented. Just to show you that most of the credit that was originated outside the banking sector. That's here, REITs and financial companies and so on. So we saw this escaping from the banks, and others were taking over the game. So, you know, basically, we saw this situation where, for example, in California, 2005, 2006, half the mortgage loans made were subprime loans. The prices had gone so high, you had to use a subprime in order to pay for your mortgage. Basically, people started to get with this idea that, well, it's okay because housing prices will go up forever. Actually, you know, what starts to happen, though, is we start to see different kinds of scenarios. One scenario is like the scenario of Detroit, Cleveland, the American Midwest, where basically incomes are collapsing. You saw recently that Detroit declared bankruptcy as its economy in the Rust Belt collapsed. Meanwhile, in other places, housing prices, as I mentioned in California's case, are going out of sight. So here's a picture of from the Case-Shiller of some of the cities in the Case-Shiller index. This, for example, let's see, we have, here is, so there's kind of a percentage change from 1992 through to 2008. These triangles are the story of Detroit and Cleveland. Notice that housing prices there never really get very high. They're on this left axis, the zero point, and then they ultimately collapse. We have basically Phoenix and Las Vegas, which were boom cities, and we see that they, you know, go into stratospheric growth of housing prices rising 25% a year for a couple of good years, where the market literally just goes crazy and stays high. And then the average you see as well. So, and of course you see the deviation growing too. So that's something that basically happened. Now again, sparing you details about the subprime crisis, essentially what we are left with is basically, you know, we know that all the details, the system melted down, there was too big to fail. There's things that I've talked about in other research, other people have talked about it, and I'll skip that now. I'm gonna stay focused on what happened or didn't happen in terms of this financial crisis. But just to say, 12 million people lost their houses. In California, about 8% of the population lost their houses. So if you just think of that, if we have a classroom full of people, take like that group over there and they all lost their house. It was very dramatic and without really much of a policy response. We saw this problem where basically there really has not been a good solution. And why not? Okay, just going back to our list of points on how Dymski saw the thing as being savable. First of all, banks were no longer the most leveraged units. Secondly, banks are no longer doing most of the lending. Thirdly, they are no longer the locus of liquidity risk. And fourthly, they're doing speculation. They're not doing productive loans. So even as they do loans, it has nothing to do with investment. And actually, the big banks are the worst. Roberto was talking about the Mexican crisis and then leading into the Brazilian and Russian crisis. First time I was here was during that crisis in 98. And at that time, that's when basically Alan Greenspan and actually Gerald Corrigan from the New York Fed called together the eight big investment banks and the mega banks in New York City and said, you will lend to save the system. And they did. That was the meltdown of long-term capital, the ruble, the heiau, all of that. But by the 2000s, 10 years later, the big banks are the biggest speculators. They're no longer the adults in the room. In fact, what we have here, you remember this picture, the banks are now on the left, and there they are with their little equity, but we now have SIVs and collateral-backed funds that essentially are all liability. It's basically a bundle of securities backed by commercial paper, typically held at a distance by a bank, maybe sold off, but often just held offshore. And then subprime households, basically borrowing to get their home. So here's a household that's basically borrowed a 228 mortgage that goes for 30-year mortgage, oops, and they've also basically borrowed their down payment. So the way this worked was you'd borrow your down payment, 15-year mortgage, you'd borrow your regular mortgage loan, it was all borrowing, and what you're counting on is that your house is gonna rise in value. When it doesn't, you're done. And that's life in America. So we have essentially, you see this, what's happening here is that basically we have subprime households moving into negative space. Banks are the non-bank funds that are the SIVs moving into negative space, and banks as well. The system basically, and the problem of course is that banks, the central bank doesn't have any vehicle for getting to these or these. Well, actually the central bank kind of does this a little bit, and that's kind of one way of looking at QE1, QE2, QE3. They basically go to some of the big banks that have had to take the mortgages and their other paper back onto their balance sheet and say, we will take your paper at par. The banks say, thank you very much. And basically the central bank takes it back, pretends it's good paper and distributes cash into the system. This is a game that's been played quite a lot. So in some sense, this is part of the Wall Street game, but believe me, ain't nobody doing that for subprime households, right? Those people are just screwed and feeling ashamed having failed the American dream. So there we are, and these are pictures that show you that the big banks were different. So essentially, we have this kind of critical encounter with Hyman Dymski. And that, there's a lot that's right about his theory, but we have to reinvent parts of it as the institutions change. And even the forms of government intervention and what we have to say about them has got to change too. And so, essentially, his idea is that we can focus on a banking system and save the banks to save the system is no longer the case. In fact, I would submit to you that we have saved the banks, some of them. We have a very high bank failure rate, but none of the too big to fail banks. They are now, they really have not shrunk their balance sheets. They are still 95% of the shadow banking system as they were before. They're now playing new games. They're now securitizing water. They're securitizing agricultural land. They're securitizing sovereign debt and backward to forward municipal debt in the United States. And basically, they are as uncontrolled as ever, and we've gotten nothing from them. So, you know, we really need a reconceptualization of what's involved. So here's Hyman Minsky's world. You know, the bank is the lender, the central bank regulates the bank, so the central bank stabilizes the bank and makes it resume lending. Here we are today. The bank is no longer the lender. The central bank doesn't regulate the lenders who operate freely. The central bank has no lever to renew productive lending in this model. That's it. The bank cannot get to, the central bank cannot get to what has to be done. And the banks where it does intervene are quite happy, actually, to, if you will, go Brazilian. They're basically quite happy to go play in the carry trade or to take some positions that basically give them safe money without taking much risk. So essentially, you know, the ability to control instability that Minsky so prized depends on institutional arrangements that themselves have proven fragile and unstable. And we, this leads us to this place where we have a profound crisis. Now, let's just look at a few pictures about Brazil. And one thing I want to do basically is to appeal to you that we need some good research. And I'll show you why. Because right now, all we got is bad research and bad data. I remember when I was in Belo Horizonte in 2010 as a visiting scholar, I had a mandate to do a workshop. I proposed to Rodrigo and some others that we do a workshop about housing prices in Brazil. And nobody really wanted to talk about that, partly was because there was no real Brazil-wide index. Every city had its own method and they were not uniform. That's actually why how we got into, I did the favela workshop instead, and so we did it 2 years in a row. And Fernando helped out the second year, so that was I think, a good trade. But basically, that said, let's look at some things. We're gonna try to look at the housing bubble in Brazil, and then I'll show you, and then we're gonna try to look at some research that seems to be about Brazil, but then I'll show you why it's really not believable and has to be set aside, and we need something better. This, by the way, goes to my first publication in Brazil, was 98, 15 years ago, in the journal published here. And at that time, we were looking at earlier periods of bubbles. And so this was basically the housing bubble in California. Look how tame it seems in comparison. There's just a nice little breaking of a wave. And at the time, then, though we were looking at Japan, now notice the basically what we have is prices that move from 100 in 1985 up to about, it seems, 280%. This is the index of land that they have. They had land and equity prices. They didn't have housing prices per se, because that's how they do it in Japan. And then we also had problems in Korea. And again, it looked like Korea's, basically, this is its equity, its equities market here was really out of control. And it's, you know, a gentler but still significant over 100% rise in its land market, its housing market. Now, by contrast, here's what we have by going to basically the FIPE index and pulling down data and showing the data. Now, what I've done here is I took, for point of comparison, Las Vegas, Nevada, which was the most crazy city in the housing bubble in the United States, and I tracked Las Vegas until it starts to go down, and so that's over, like, what is it, like 84 quarters. But, you know, so you start Las Vegas in January 2000, and then you roll it, starting it at 100. And then I just there's the 20 city index, so we did that as well. Now, I then took the FIPE for Sao Paulo and Rio de Janeiro, And if you look at that, it first of all looks like Rio de Janeiro is the champion of champions in terms of housing price speculation, in terms of housing price bubble, even higher than Japan at the height of the crazy crisis that caused the Japan economy to crash and never come back. But one thing I would have to say now is that what is this index? Well, this is the Case-Shiller index. I would urge you to check it out. There is a concept in microeconomics called hedonic pricing, where what you do is you take an asset that has multiple components, like maybe this water, and you might find three or four dimensions of this good, and you try to do some pricing that allows you to appreciate the contribution of each of the dimensions of the water, maybe where it comes from, how toxic it is, or, you know, how much salt, whatever, how much each of these components contribute to its price. So that when you have a price, you understand the price as the price of a bundled set of, in a sense, a bundled set of characteristics. You try to use a lot of data about many houses, in this case, to sort out, you know, what does it mean when a certain price has a certain house has a certain price. And based on that, they come up with some hedonic indexes. And what you're seeing there for, like, Las Vegas in the cities are the averages of the hedonic price movements. What you're seeing there, well, let's see. It comes from Sao Paulo, so it must be true, right? Okay, so what is the FIPE index? Hold on just a second. Now, the other thing about it is that notice that essentially what we do see is that there's a lot of variety. When the housing prices come down, they come down differently at different rates. This is just a second picture about the U.S. experience, and really just to show you here that, you know, like, there's Detroit on the bottom, the light blue. It never really, you know, it doesn't really boom, and it busts more. There's Las Vegas, which busts terribly. Los Angeles falls less, but there's some variety of experience. I took the rest of the FIPE cities, which only start in later years. We looked at Sao Paulo and Rio de Janeiro because they go back to 2008. They started with some other cities in April 2009, and I just graphed them. What you can, and I, by the way, I put here, well, actually, excuse me. We're gonna do this in two stages. First, here is Sao Paulo and Rio, and then some of the bigger cities. And you can see that they're all kind of on the same trajectory, just less. And then we're gonna do, and you can see that we then go to, they've now added even more cities more recently, and you can see how, again, you kind of put the trajectory down a bit more, and you get, you know, you get the same, but it's kind of, they're all kind of going in the same direction. There's a kind of super speculative pressure in Rio, but there's kind of upward price movement all through Brazil, it seems. Now, meanwhile, we have household credit growing, and we know that this is the outstanding feature of bank balance sheets in Brazil, is the growth in commercial, you know, credit to persons. Let me skip this data because it's old. And what do we learn about this? Well, we learn a number of things, it seems we just found that there was a housing price bubble in Brazil. We then go to the Federal Reserve Bank of New York, a very fine and official institution, and we find this working paper. And what do we read? Now, those of you who are who have saudades for development economics, just, you know, look at the language. We use a recent policy experiment in Rio de Janeiro. Okay, so everything's a policy experiment now, right? The installation of permanent police stations, the UPP, right, UPP, to quantify a reduction, the relationship between reduced crime and the change in the prices of nearby residential real estate, using a novel data set of detailed property prices from an online classifieds website, we find that the new police stations had a substantial effect on the trajectory of property values and certain crime statistics since it began in 2008. We also find that the extent of inequality among residential prices decreased. Both of these empirical observations are consistent with the dynamic model, blah, blah, blah. Okay, Federal Reserve of New York. And they go through, and here's what they tell us. Real estate prices are drawn from the house price, Immoves, section of the online classifieds website, Zap. We got a confidential extract. Each observation is a simple average of housing prices across certain characteristics, number of rooms, et cetera. And then we computed things by square meter, and we got many observations and many an impressive number of property listings, and so they could do their econometrics and blah, 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 right? So basically, they're dealing with something like this. Favela trading in Rio de Janeiro, real estate business gone mad. Now, the interesting thing about this is that basically, you know, you look at this and you ask yourself, well, wait a minute, where did those FIPE numbers come from? And actually, they came from the same source. Now, what is the Zap index? You tell them what you're listing your price at, your house at, and then you tell them how many rooms, how many square feet, etc., and they list it. Punto. That's it. Is it data about what the market did? No. Is it data about people's fantasies about what they wish would happen? Yes. Is my home in Copacabana worth, oh, I don't know, how about 3 million reais? Definitely. No doubt. It's, how about 4 million? Let me list it tomorrow, right? What does this tell you? Nothing. So you're in a situation where people are pretending this is real data, and my point to you would be, it is a fact that we see a lot more consumer borrowing. It is a fact that we see rapid growth in the home mortgage market in Brazil. And I would mention to you that a problem that we've had all the way through with the subprime crisis is that we never had good data on what is a subprime loan. Partly because good old Alan Greenspan would not implement the law that would have required some reporting. We also now have no public data on foreclosures. So we have a crisis in the United States that is invisible. It's invisible in part because it's focused on portions of the population that are lower income and that are socially excluded. And these are people that are throwaway people in many ways of looking at the United States, where we don't need their labor power anymore necessarily in the world of the global factory. But aren't these the people who hit the streets in Los Angeles in 1992? Aren't these the people that pay for bus rides? Aren't these the people who are trying to have a life? And I would just suggest, you know, without extending the analogies further, again, you can see that that craziness of financing 100% of your house price with very low interest rates, there's the Greenspan put, and there's the problems of Federal Reserve monetary policy, all of that for sure. But that's not what's happening in Brazil. But what is happening in Brazil is a rise in housing markets that seems to be happening around the country in a situation where we have no good data on what's going on. We're not tracking it well. We don't know. We're blind to the phenomenon. And as we enter what may be a more difficult period of economic activity for Brazil, I would suggest that at the very least, we should have better data, better information, and some serious research on what exactly is going on with the lending markets, and especially the housing lending markets and the housing market itself in Brazilian cities. Because right now, we know next to nothing, and that is not a situation that will enable positive policy to respond to difficulties that the everyday Brazilian population is having as it struggles to become the mass consumption Brazil, as it struggles to become the prosperous Brazil with a new middle class. We don't need that taken out by crisis, so let's get busy and do some research. Thank you very much.
Gary, parabéns palestra brilhante. Eu vou focar no final da palestra. Eu acho que são fenômenos incomparáveis à bolha imobiliária norte-americana, com a bolha localizada em alguns bairros no Rio. A minha hipótese, que eu queria que você, quer dizer, refutasse ou concordasse, é, nos Estados Unidos, essa bolha foi financiada, tinha crédito. A bolha no Rio de Janeiro é por um excesso de demanda em áreas localizadas, num mercado informal. Pegar o exemplo da Zona Sul, citou Copacabana, Ipanema, Leblon. Os preços disparam pelo excesso de demanda, pelas trações que está ao Rio, pela boa parte da demanda de estrangeiros. Os preços sobem, a compra das casas não tem liquidez, a pessoa não vende fácil, com grande dificuldade, mesmo com o preço elevando, mas não há muitos negócios, há uma pura especulação, porque não há financiamento para residências de alto valor acima de 1 milhão. Agora é que estão falando em financiar acima de 1 milhão. Então, há uma peculiaridade no Brasil residências de alto valor são pagas à vista. Quer dizer, a concentração de riqueza permite de que, vou falar uma expressão antiga, mas a burguesia regional compre casas no Rio para esses próximos 4 anos, para desfrutar da Copa, da Olimpíadas, da demanda pré-sal. Então, mas não há muita liquidez para as casas, principalmente da classe média. Então, há um efeito riqueza. A pessoa se sente mais rica, mas ela não realiza o ganho e não vai para o consumo, como é nos Estados Unidos. É uma falsa riqueza. Isso no aspecto, digamos, mais zona sul, classe média. Nas favelas, aí que o mercado é inteiramente formal, porque não há financiamento da Caixa Econômica Federal, que é o único banco que financia baixa renda. Ele financia conjuntos habitacionais fora da favela, ou então só em favelas onde há urbanização. São algumas regiões com experiência de urbanização de favela que está vendo. Rocinha, Complexo do Alemão, então está vendo. Então, eu não vejo muita comparação. Se a gente pegar, existe correlação, mas não existe causalidade. Porque o crédito habitacional dispara mesmo. Porque antes não era concedido nada. A gente fez uma série de reformas, o crédito habitacional disparou. Os preços dos imóveis disparam, mas não é causa. A minha hipótese é essa. Não é causado pelo crédito.
Boa noite, quase. Meu nome é Raul, eu sou doutorando aqui do IE, e minha pesquisa é em real estate, no Brasil, só que é na Amazônia, eu sou de Belém, no caso, que nem apareceu na pesquisa, e que tem um dos metros quadrados também tão altos quanto São Paulo e Rio, em alguns bairros. Só que o diferencial, e é muito mais uma contribuição do que uma pergunta, e também concordando com o professor Fernando falou, que o crédito não é uma relação, e muito mais a relação do imóvel como uma reserva de valor e como investimento, e especificamente na periferia do Brasil, esse investimento ele está muito ligado também às elites regionais, mas também às elites do agronegócio, que é a nossa impressão, porque, como o resto do Brasil, a gente mesmo que não tem dados, nem a FIP deve aparecer lá, porque nem o Zap Imóveis tem em Belém, eu acho. Ou seja, é uma coisa muito mercantil, muito primária, esse trato do preço da terra, preço do imóvel, e eu digo que é primário porque, além de tudo, não sou economista, sou arquiteto. Então, eu já trabalhava com imóveis, com projetos e tal, então eu sei como é que é o que está por trás dessa valorização, e é basicamente uma valorização do quanto o teu concorrente está podendo aplicar o preço, Não tem a ver com crédito, o preço é o quanto o teu concorrente está colocando o metro quadrado e o quanto ele está vendendo, e aí eu coloco o mesmo preço. Mas o empírico que está acontecendo em Belém, eu vejo pelas nossas conversas, junto com a professora Mariana também, o que está acontecendo em Fortaleza e tudo, é uma relação desse imóvel como uma reserva de valor do investimento de parcelas dessa riqueza na periferia do agronegócio. Em Belém é a soja, é a pecuária e tudo, que está direcionando esse imóvel, e não para residência, mas investimento na ideia, e aí sim tem uma relação com os Estados Unidos, porque a ideia é que esse imóvel vai sempre se valorizar. E aí a relação é basicamente essa, porque eles não têm pressa de vender os imóveis, os prédios eles são inaugurados e ficam vazios. A minha pesquisa de mestrado apontou que, do censo de 2000 para 2010, o número de aluguel, de apartamento que é alugado em Belém, subiu, pelo IBGE, tá? Que é o dado que eu achei mais confiável, subiu em torno de 50%, muito mais do que nos outros anos. E coincide, nesse período, com a entrada das empresas que se financeirizam, as empresas do Eixo Rio-São Paulo em Belém. E aí a produção imobiliária também dispara. Mas, só para complementar e novamente explicar por que é difícil conseguir dados, o registro disso, você não consegue ter acesso porque ele é extremamente... como é que eu posso dizer? Ele tem uma relação, uma economia política ali com a população, com a prefeitura, as normas às vezes não são seguidas. Então, o acesso a esses dados, um básico, que é o estoque habitacional, você também não tem esse acesso. De tal maneira que, por que a gente tem que se basear nos app imóveis? É um pouco em função disso, né? Mas eu estou falando da minha experiência em Belém. E é isso.
Pois é, né?
Yeah, thank you. This problem of the uneven character and the differences, this, here we are with this new situation. Let me say a few things. First, the point about the bubble being focused in some places but not being uniform is completely, that was also the pattern in the United States. And one of the reasons why there has been no effective government intervention is that the subprime crisis hit different places in different ways and missed places also. It was not uniform. It was a historically complex event. And so there was sort of no one solution that it wasn't like all the banks failed. And so that's something that makes for some complexity in terms of policy response. Secondly, the fact that, now let's go to Fernando's point about the informal, the fact that so much of this is on informal space. And here's an example of foreigners moving in, and as a there are some other very provocative and strange videos that this first one, I'll leave this. This first one is about basically, if I remember well, something like 3 million people have seen this. This is the video of the Bapi going into Hosinia and cleaning it up. It's a 10-minute video. 3 or 4 million people saw this one. I've been working a lot in Mare, Complexo de Mare, and actually about 25 people have seen this next one, which is a discussion in the community with Eliana Souza Silva and other people that we work with, who are sitting in a community center basically talking about the police violence against young people in the community for no reason as the UPP came in. And again, you know, 16 people are, you know, 60 people watching this versus 3 million. And this one here, if I remember well, is a YouTube video about something called District 55 that's been set up there in Complexo de Alamao. And it's kind of an arts center that is going to be a space for people to interact, foreigners with favelas and so on. And it's a very strange reality, because it's something like, you know, they were criticizing, well, we don't like these tours where it's like going and looking at people in a zoo. But, you know, what is that? I mean, it's just, you know, what does all of this mean? And what does it mean for the communities? What does it mean for people where basically housing has not been defined as investment, but it's been defined as your home? Believe me, my home in Copacabana is not worth 3 million reais, even under these conditions. Nothing close to that, but it doesn't matter. It's where we live. It's not about that. And that's been, you know, we like Copacabana because it's kind of, it's a community that we get and we feel comfortable and we know people all around where we are. It's our place. And speaking of Silvana and I, and that's what we imagine as human community. Now the thing is, there are even more dramatic pictures, as you know, of and more dramatic YouTube videos of people in living in favela now, where the house will be designated for destruction, and then people will get like 500 reais, or how about 5,000 reais, or, you know, pick a number and say like, here's your reais, good luck. And that person has no chance to live anywhere except the west or the north of the favelas in Rio de Janeiro, or maybe off in the boonies out in Niterói. And you know, those places are wild, wild west. Those places used to be kind of tranquil places, and now people are getting shot down in daylight, or the Baixa Fluminense, you know, as basically the drug business moves, the young people move, the problems move, and they're what? Out of sight. Okay, so we basically move people out without respecting their human rights or community rights. Maybe you can argue we respect the community, the human rights, but what about their right to the community? And that is now gone. Those who stay can try to sell that. But, you know, there's nothing's on paper, and it's all, as you say, money on site, because all of these relationships are precarious, and so the state is protected. And, you know, one of the things that we saw as a very important dynamic in the favela workshop was the idea of formalização. People want to be part of the city. In fact, actually what happened in the workshop that Fernando came, it went for 2 days in BNDS. And on the second day, actually the favela leaders took over the workshop. So we had a schedule, but Ricardo Henriquez was there in dialogue with the group for the whole afternoon. It was an amazing moment, as you saw the power and the passion of those communities and the residents of those communities who wanted a voice and who were real and who were there. Now, that is something that, you know, this is a moment, right? I mean, if we think of, in the US, 1994, you know, we tried to do something about the subprime, and there's more of a story. We tried to stop it, and we tried lawsuits, nothing worked. And then 12 years later, or 13 years later, blows up. Okay, so do we want to do something like right now, like displacing all these people, as we make nice zones available for foreign investments and clean it up, all through the zones that are going to be nice for the World Cup? And basically, do you want to go 10 years and see what happens? You know, I don't think we do. We don't have to go there. So that's something that that has to be right on the table. Everything that we put on the table in that favela workshop, we haven't seen follow-up. It needs more. There needs to be a push. There needs to be a push, and it's got to be a bottom-up push. About investment, just a couple of words, and about the Northeast. So I already hit your idea about housing as investment, but let me just say something about Fortaleza and some of the cities in the Northeast. Another thing that is actually happening both in the U.S. and here, and in Spain, is this idea, and actually the Northeast of Brazil was already in front of this process. The buy-to-let market, European tourists coming and buying, you know, in those cities, they have these buildings like this, and then you have your apartment, and that's your place. And then the idea was you would go there and stay there for 3 weeks, and then the rest of the time you would rent the place, so you would have income and have a vacation home in Fortaleza or one of the other cities. Nice, right? But actually, what those things do is they disrupt the structure and the pattern of communities. If we go to the cities in the Northeast now, they make less and less sense. The integrity of the city as a lived community is kind of destroyed in many cases, because basically we have these vacant spaces, speculative real estate, and then of course the tourist hotels right on the beach and all that, that just kind of destroys the idea of what that community was. And so, you know, those of us who know Carjim Carvalho know that one joke about Carjim Carvalho is he's always searching for the perfect beach in the Northeast. Now, what is Fernando looking for, actually, other than he wants to get away from it all? Fernando's looking for the fantasy of what the Northeast was, right? The beach, the community, everybody living in peace and harmony, and everything fine. And that is like gone, right? I mean, that world is in another kind of motion. And the thing about the buy-to-let is actually, this is a huge problem in British cities now. In fact, I've got a project I'm building. If you're interested, let me know, because we're looking for people. With Andrew Leishon and Sean French and some others, we're going to build a project to look at buy-to-let in Spain, we hope in Brazil, and maybe the US and England. And one thing about buy-to-let, part of it is purpose-built housing. Like if we go along the River Tyne in Newcastle, or the River Aire in Leeds, or you know, London and so on. You know, lots of London exception, but the other places, there are huge problems. However, another thing is where basically lots of real estate becomes available because of foreclosure, bank owned. What's happening now is that JP Morgan Chase, Goldman Sachs, private equity funds are going in and buying thousands of homes in California, in Spain, and in other places. They're going to be owners of these homes. Now, what are they doing? Are they land banking? Are they becoming permanent landlords? Well, it just looks like a good investment. But again, think of what that means for the possibility of wealth accumulation. At least, now this is the US model, and that model is mostly broken. But the US model was that you saved in your house. You were supposed to buy a house when you were 30, hold the house until you retired, and then you'd live in your house, and that would be your main asset. That was the way it was supposed to work. That's gone, especially when half the houses in your neighborhood are now owned by JP Morgan Chase. And so that vision of it's just an asset actually is completely in tension with the idea of sustaining reproducible and viable human communities. And I would say that in the favelas of Brazil, in the cities, many of the cities in inland California, in Detroit, these questions, and in other places, these questions are very much on the table. And we do not have governments at this point that have the vision to respond. So, you know, but I think it does start with, I mean, we can do our part with better research to make these things visible and to connect the dots, because too many of these problems are under the surface, in communities that have no effective voice. Thanks for your attention.
Obrigado novamente, Gary. Bom, só um aviso, na sexta-feira nós temos ainda mais um seminário com o professor Giovanni Dosi, né? Então, estão todos convidados. Obrigado a todos aí pela presença e até sexta.